Hello and welcome to today's PIR live event webinar brought to you by Partners in Research Canada. My name is Stacey Joyce and I will be your host. If you're joining us live, remember that you can ask questions anytime throughout the webinar by clicking the chat button in the top left corner of your screen. Just make sure when you type in your question that you include where you're from or perhaps even which of your students by first name ask that question if it's from a particular student. We would love to give you a shout out when we ask your question. Today's guest is Dr. Ayush Kumar. He is an associate professor in the Department of Microbiology at the University of Manitoba. Thank you so much for joining us, Dr. Kumar. I will turn it over to you.
Thank you very much, Stacey. And it's a pleasure to be here this morning talking about antibiotic resistance and water. So, Stacey, you already provided an introduction. I am an associate professor in the Department of Microbiology at University of Manitoba, and this is basically a snapshot of our university, and this is the Buller Building where I'm talking to you from. My office is somewhere right here, so it's a beautiful campus, and this is where I am this morning. So I would like to start with an introduction to microbiology. What is microbiology? Now, microbiology is a study of organisms, living organisms that are too small to be seen with naked eyes. And these would include bacteria, viruses, and also single-celled eukaryotes. So here in this figure, if you look at this figure, we are basically classified different organisms based on their size. So we have some large animals here. This would be a tick, and this is a human egg. And these are some of the structures or organisms that we can see through our naked eye. So this is basically the limit of our unaided human eye. But there are organisms which are much smaller than that, which we cannot detect or see with our naked eye. And these organisms include bacteria. There are also pathogens like viruses. And they are too small to be seen with naked eye. So to visualize these organisms, we need some sort of aid. And generally what we use here is different kind of microscopes. And microbiology is the study of these organisms. So in a nutshell, microbiology is the study of organisms that we cannot see with our unaided eyes. So we in our lab work with bacteria. And as some of you might have heard, bacteria tend to get a lot of bad name in press. We always talk about bad bacteria because these are agents that can cause some serious disease. So the question is, are bacteria good or bad? And one thing to keep in mind is that we as humans, we are home to more than 100 trillion different bacterial or microorganisms. So we carry a lot of microorganisms in or on our body. For example, the moist areas in our body, such as underarm, the body odor that comes from these moist areas is primarily a product, breakdown product of our sweat molecules. And what is breaking down our sweat molecules? These are bacterial cells. If you look at your hand, you will, and if you were able to visualize all bacteria that are present on our hand, you'll realize that we actually have more microbes on our hand than there are people on the planet. So we actually have very large number of living organisms on our hand. So if you are able to combine all these microorganisms that are present in our body, their total weight is almost up to 2 kg, which is weight of an average human brain or an ostrich egg or even a small dog. So we carry a lot of microorganisms on us, in us, and these organisms carry out some useful processes for us. For example, digestion of food, a major component or a major participant in helping us digest our food is are the microorganisms that are present in our gut. So they do carry out a lot of useful functions for us. They also contribute to variety of industrial processes. So for example, cheese making is dependent on bacteria. Bread making is dependent on yeast. If you eat any kind of fermented food, sauerkraut, for example, even chocolate, that is fermented by bacteria. Microorganisms also play a role in production of different medicines, antibiotics, cholesterol-lowering drugs. Microorganisms play a role in cleaning up our environment. So whenever there's a spill, oil spill, or spill of any other harmful products, it's usually microorganisms that convert those harmful products into benign or less harmful products. Bacteria are also involved in agriculture. So what they do is they make food available for our crop plants, and this way they keep our plants and crops healthy. So bacteria play in general a very important role in our lives, on our body, in our body, and outside our body. However, there is a small proportion of bacterial cells or bacterial types that impact our health in a negative way. So a number of these bacterial species can cause serious infections, diseases like cholera, diseases like plague, malaria, smallpox, HIV/AIDS, or TB. These are caused by microorganisms, and these are some of the bad microorganisms. So when we get sick, especially from a bacterial infection, we take antibiotics for treatment, and usually we take antibiotics for a period of 7 to 10 days, and we get better. And because antibiotics are the medicines that are used to treat bacterial infections. So antibiotics help us stay healthy, help us treat infections. But what is happening now is that because of more and more use of antibiotic, bacteria are becoming resistant to antibiotics. So basically, this is how antibiotics work. Here we have a bacterial cell. This is an image we took using electron microscope. And when we treat it with antibiotics, the cell dies because antibiotics literally destroy the cell. So here you have the cell, bacterial cell, which was treated with antibiotic, and it just explodes. So when these cells die, that's how we treat infections. But as I said, because of enhanced use of antibiotics, we are starting to see antibiotic resistance. Now, what is antibiotic resistance? Antibiotic resistance is the phenomena by which bacterial cells can survive the action of antibiotics. So here what we see is that here we have a population of bacterial cells, and in this population, we have one cell that may be resistant to antibiotics. And when we use antibiotics, so let's say that we treat this population with antibiotics, and these structures sort of resemble antibiotics, all the cells that are susceptible to antibiotics will die, whereas the one resistant cell will survive. And as a result, what happens is now this resistant cell can multiply and divide. And now what you have is new population of bacterial cells, which are all resistant to antibiotics. So what is primarily happening here is that if we have more antibiotics in our environment, then they can select for resistant organisms, resistant bacteria. Now you can imagine if somebody gets sick from an infection by this population of cells, it'll be very difficult to treat infection caused by these cells because these are resistant to antibiotics, which means that we cannot really use antibiotics to kill these bacterial cells. So what actually happens to antibiotics that we use? And before we talk about that, Let's talk a little bit about bacteria in our nature. So what is primarily happening is that we have hospitals, we have in our communities, households, and we are generating a lot of waste. And all this waste tends to get into our environment and primarily ends up in our water bodies. So, and these water bodies will contain bacteria. Bacteria are everywhere. So they are present in these water bodies as well. And if we happen to have antibiotics coming from these sources, our houses, our hospitals, and get into our water bodies, what they can do is essentially what we just saw in the previous slide, that they can select for resistant organisms. So it's water can actually serve as an environment where we can have selection for resistant organisms. And water, as we know, is extremely precious. Why is water precious? Because even though our planet is, there's a lot of water on our planet. If you look at planet Earth from space, it looks blue because of the presence of water. However, there's very small proportion of water that can be used for human consumption. So 98% of all water present on Earth is salty water. So only 2% is fresh. And of that 2%, almost 90% is frozen. And about 12% is groundwater. So in our rivers and lakes, we only have about 1% of water, total water, that we can drink. So we don't have a very large amount of water that can be used for human consumption. So what do we do? In order to use for the maximal use of this water that is available for our consumption, what we do is we basically take water from our natural resources and we treat this water, and then we distribute this water to our households. So we distribute this water to our households where we consume this water, we drink this water, we cook with this water, and then this water is released back into our water bodies. So this cycle continues because we treat our water and then it goes back for us to drink. So this cycle is very important. This cycle ensures that we have pure, clean, safe drinking water for our consumption. Now, this is a reality in developed countries, because in developed countries, we are lucky that we have access to this this water, which has been clean, which has been made safe for drinking. A lot of developing countries don't have that option. And water, because it plays such an important role in our lives, can be a major source of diseases, especially bacterial infections. So if you look at this slide here, different parts of the world, this is basically showing deaths in children who are younger than 5 years, and the causes of death. So what I would focus on here is the pie chart with purple color on this on it. So this purple color is basically showing the proportion of deaths as a result of diarrheal disease. Diarrheal diseases are primarily acquired through unsafe water. So if water is not cleaned properly for human consumption, then it can serve as a source for pathogens, bacteria that cause diarrhea. And you see around the world, especially in poorer countries and developing countries, diarrheal disease is a major cause of death in children who are younger than 5 years old. And this is directly linked to the fact that a lot of these countries don't have resources or means to clean their water before humans consume it. So cleaning water, access to clean water is extremely important, and access to clean water has been identified as a human right by United Nations. So United Nations says that everybody on this planet should have access to clean water, but the reality is that most of us on this planet don't have access to clean water. So what about Canada? We talked about developing countries where access to clean water is a problem. In Canada too, we have small pockets of small communities where Access to clean drinking water is a huge problem, especially in our First Nation communities. So for example, in Manitoba, where I am right now, about 10% of the homes in First Nation communities have no running water, and they have to carry their water from various distances. And a lot of these communities actually have access to water which is not safe for drinking because they contain high number of bacteria. So even in Canada, in a developed country like Canada, we have Canadians who don't have access to clean water. So we talked about antibiotics a little while ago, and we talked about water and how you have bacteria in water and how it is so important to remove bacteria from water to make it safe for drinking. Otherwise, water can pose a risk to human health. Now think about all the antibiotics we are using. Think about antibiotics that we use in our hospitals. Think about antibiotics that we use in our households. And this antibiotic molecule, which is basically discarded in our toilets, in our sinks, can make its way to our water bodies. And let's say that our water bodies, we know that they contain bacteria, and now you have antibiotics in there. So these antibiotics, what they would do is they would select for resistant organisms. Now, the water treatment becomes extremely important, because if people are consuming this water without treatment, then they are not only prone to get bacterial infections, but they are also prone to get infections that are resistant to antibiotics. And this is what we study in our lab. What we study is the prevalence of antibiotic-resistant bacteria in drinking water supplies from First Nation communities in Manitoba. So basically, what we are showing here is that you have water bodies that may contain one or two resistant bacteria, and when antibiotic molecule from different sources end up in these water bodies, then we have a population of resistant bacteria. So how do we study antibiotic resistance in water? What we do is we look at the DNA of bacteria that is present in the water samples. Because what actually happens is that the resistant bacteria and bacterium that is susceptible to antibiotics may have tiny differences in their DNA molecule. So they both contain DNA molecule, but they would have tiny differences. As you know, DNA is the hereditary material, as the genetic material, and resistance in bacteria is a genetic trait, which means that the genetic signature of this bacterium, which is resistant to antibiotics, would be different from this bacterium, which is susceptible to antibiotics. So what we do is we look for these traits, and if we find these traits which make a bacterium resistant to antibiotic, then we can assume, or we can make assumption here, that our water sample contains antibiotic-resistant bacteria. So that's antibiotics, selecting resistant organisms, resistant bacteria in water. Are there other factors that can select for resistant bacteria? And one of the things that we study in our lab is effect of antibacterial household products in selecting for resistant bacteria. So I'm sure if you go around, go to supermarket, and if you look around, you'll see that antibacterial products are very, very common these days. There are toothpaste that are antibacterial. There are soaps that are antibacterial. Cosmetics can be antibacterial. Shopping carts are antibacterial. Fabrics, you can actually buy clothing which is antibacterial. Office supplies that can be antibacterial, kitchen supplies that are antibacterial. So what makes these products antibacterial? They contain molecules which are not antibiotics, but they act in a similar fashion as antibiotics. So what they do is they kill bacteria, and this is how they reduce bacterial load in these products. However, what happens is that these molecules can get into our water body. They do get into our water bodies, and then again, they can select for resistant organisms. Now, these are not antibiotics, but when they select for resistant organisms, they select for organisms that are resistant not only to these antibacterial compounds, but also to antibiotics that are found, that are used in our hospitals. So these compounds or these products, when we use these products in our households, we are actually enhancing the risk of selecting for resistant organisms. So what can we all do to prevent antibiotic resistance? Well, the most important thing is to use antibiotics only when it's needed. A lot of us may take antibiotics when we have cold, but 80% of cold cases are actually caused by viruses, and antibiotics don't work on viruses. So there is no point in taking antibiotic if we have viral infection. Antibiotics should only be taken when we have bacterial infection. And the other thing that we can all do in our households is to avoid using antibacterial household products. These household products they are not any better than regular products in removing bacteria. So for example, if you wash your hand with regular soap, you will remove same number of bacteria as you would by using antibacterial soap. So they don't do any, they're not any better than regular products. However, when they get into our water bodies, in our environment, they can cause more harm. So these are few small changes we can bring about in our lifestyle to prevent antibiotic resistance. So with that, I'll end here and I'll be happy to take any questions.
Well, thank you so much for that. You've already answered one of my questions, which is going to be what our students can do to combat the antibiotic resistance that you've discussed. And for questions, what I would really like is if you could click the stop share button at the top of your screen, Dr. Kumar, then we'll be able to see you a little bit larger. Perfect, while you answer questions. So what I wanted to start with was this process of selection that you mentioned. So you talked about selection for antibiotic resistant bacteria. Can you perhaps explain what you mean by that term?
So by selection, I think the easiest way to describe that would be, you know, the old saying, whatever doesn't kill us makes us stronger. So in a group of bacterial cells population, you would have bacterial cells that respond differently to antibiotic. So there might be one which may be stronger than others and would resist the action of antibiotics. So now when we have antibiotic in the environment, all the weaker cells will die and the stronger one survives. Because this cell is stronger and it has that trait in its DNA, all the cells that are produced by these cells are now strong as well. So now we have a population of strong cells, and this is, we are selecting now a cell which was resistant to antibiotic, and now we have an entire population which is now resistant.
Right. I think what's important for our students to understand is the idea that bacteria are always multiplying as much as they can, as much as their surroundings will allow, that idea of they're only limited by their space and food, sort of.
That's a very good point. And bacteria, they replicate much, much faster. They divide much, much faster than any human can. E. coli, for example, in our labs would divide every 20 minutes. So within 24 hours, if there's unlimited food supply, one E. coli cell can divide into millions and millions of cells. So, and just imagine if there's this process of selection going on at the same time, within 24 hours, we'll have millions and millions of resistant cells.
Right. So that's how that one cell in your image turned into a whole population of resistant cells. If all the other non-resistant ones are out of the way, then there's so much room to grow and take over.
Exactly.
What a scary thought. Okay. So that answers that question. How can we find a solution for this problem of antibiotic resistance? What do you think?
So the solution is not going to be easy. And the solution will involve everybody. And that's why I think it's so important that our audience members today do their part as well. This is a global problem. These days, you know, within 24 hours, I can travel from one part of this planet to any part on this planet, which means that if I'm carrying an antibiotic resistant bacteria, within 24 hours, I can spread it anywhere on this planet. So the solution has to be global, which means that everybody on this planet has to buy in, because let's say that we make efforts here in Canada, that really won't protect us, because we have people traveling these days and bacteria don't know any boundaries or borders. The key thing is to, again, just going back to the first question you asked about bacteria dividing so fast. So we have to remember that resistance will happen regardless. What we can do best is to slow it down. And so responsible use of antibiotics, not insisting. A number of physicians actually complain that patients insist on getting antibiotics when they are sick, even if they have viral infection. And that's the sort of pressure that we shouldn't really be putting on our physicians. Using products that are not antimicrobial that is the kind of choice we need to make. So what we need to do is somehow reduce the concentration of antibiotic in our environment, because right now we have a lot of antimicrobials going into our environment. One thing I didn't mention during my talk is that 80% of all antibiotics that are produced in Canada are actually used on the farm, not on humans, on animals. So when we use an antibiotic molecule on the farm, we are actually spraying it on the soil, we are putting it in the water, and it's getting into our environment. And these are the uses, these are the avenues that we need to sort of plug in where we are releasing a lot of antibiotics into the environment.
Right. So we already talked about, and you just touched on it again, the idea that our students can choose to use, say, a hand soap that is not antimicrobial, and that will be just as effective for washing their hands. I think that's important to know. They're not sacrificing anything by making that choice. That's maybe arguably a marketing thing in saying something is antimicrobial and thus more effective. But you also mentioned the issue of access to clean water, and that is a global issue, but maybe surprising to some, it's actually an issue within our own home country here in Canada. Is there anything that you would suggest to students who hear that and think, what can I do to make this better?
I think one of the most important things is actually we need to talk more about that issue as well. 6 years ago, I didn't know that this was such a huge problem in Canada. In Canada, we are very lucky. We can drink water from any tap that is out there without worrying about getting sick. And we don't realize that how big of a privilege that is, because 70 to 80% of population on this planet doesn't have that option. However, in our own backyard, we have communities where they are drinking water which is worse than any water that you can pick from around the world. So the very first thing is to actually appreciate the problem, because we don't talk about this problem enough. A lot of us are not aware of this problem. And then comes the technological requirements. We need to make sure that we have expertise within these communities where we can have water treatment plants in place. A lot of these communities don't have water treatment plant. We need to make sure that we have expertise within these communities, and we have individuals who are willing to help these communities with maintaining these water treatment plants. So that's also a challenge. So I think discussing this issue and coming up with ideas in how to effectively clean water. One example is as a student, probably same age group as the audience members today in Michigan, came up with a handheld device which cleans up lead from water. So these are some of the technological advances that can come from students if they are aware of the problem. I think one of the challenges as well, if we are not aware of the problem, then how do we find the solution?
Right, of course. Well, we are running out of time, but I do want to ask you before we go a little bit about your pathway to becoming a microbiologist. What did that pathway look like? And maybe what advice would you have for students who might want to pursue something similar?
So when I started my university, like most of students, my friends, I wanted to go into medicine. And then when I started university, I came across a professor who used to tell me wonderful stories about microbiology and microbiologists. And I realized that these organisms, they're so small, they're out of our sight because we don't really see them, how important role they play in our lives. And that's basically what got me interested in microbiology and reading more and more about the advances that were going on in the field, understanding and appreciating what microbes do for us was the major reason why I actually got interested in the topic. So I think for students, the biggest advice I would have is and it doesn't have to be microbiology, but anything they are interested in, just try to learn as much as possible. These days, I think the advantage is, compared to back in my days, is knowledge is readily available. You just have to go seek it, and it's really easy. It's actually available at your homes. It's available with you anytime where you are. So whatever you are interested in, read up more on that. Try to get a better understanding of what it is, what it entails, and I'm sure you'll find something interesting to do within that.
Well, thank you so much for joining us today and sharing your expertise and your advice as well. And I'm sure our students have a lot to think about. So thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity.
And next on PIR Live Event, we continue to celebrate Science Odyssey with a webinar and classroom activity about forensic science and blood stains. More information about PIR Live Event webinars and other PIR educational programming is available at pirweb.org. Thanks so much, everyone, and I hope you have a wonderful day.